Eeny, meeny, miny, mo.
Should I watch this video?
Is it going to be a yes or no?
If you want to learn about choices, please don't go.
Well done, well done. So as you heard, today we're going to be talking about choices.
Mm-hmm. And why are choices important? Because as human beings, we all have free moral agency. Since our inception, since our design, since our creation.
I was going to say, more like creation, yeah. Which came first, the chicken or the egg?
Incepted in God's mind.
Which came first, the chicken or the egg?
I don't understand.
What came first, the chicken or the egg?
The chicken.
Why? Why?
Because the chicken had to lay the egg.
Because God created it.
Choices are important to healthy relationships. Why? Because from the moment we were incepted in God's mind, He gave us choice. He said, I am going to design a human being and they're going to have free moral agency. He could have made us like the angels to worship Him. So those were beings that were created without choice, but He gave us choice. And then He gave the choice to Adam and Eve. He said, you should eat or not eat. If you eat, you die. What choice did they make?
They made the choice to eat the fruit.
They made the choice to eat, right? And now we are suffering with the consequences of those choices. Thank you, Adam and Eve. We'll talk about this when we get to heaven.
Yeah, and then beyond that, you got Cain and Abel. Mm-hmm. Because Cain, God comes to him and says, Cain, you do actually have a choice, you know. Mm-hmm. You can choose to do good and you too will be accepted. And exactly. What did he say? And so he goes over to his brother and he then made the choice to get rid of him.
Mm, yeah, sadly topped his brother. Then we go to some people who made some good choices. So there was Rebecca, right? Eliezer comes over to her. He expresses, you know, everything that Isaac is and tells her, you know, I know you've never met this guy, but actually he's an awesome guy. And you know what? If you believe what I'm saying to you, you could be one happy lady. And she decides to listen and she goes over and she marries Isaac and she is happy. And it's a great story, right? Then you've got Esther as well, who decides to go and see the king. So in those days, the king had to call you to his audience. But because her people were at risk of being killed, Esther decides that, you know what? I'm going to make a choice to stand for my people. And she goes there and risks her life. But that choice ends up saving her people and giving them a way out.
And it's interesting that that story comes after another lady who had to make a decision, but she made a bad choice because the great king, well, apparently history says it was Xerxes. I'm not entirely sure how true that is, but anyway, the king, it's Ahasuerus, they say he was Xerxes. That's what history says. But anyway, the king is feeling great on this particular day and he says, Queen Vashti, could you come over here, please, so I can show you off to my nobles over here?
And she's a bit feminist in that moment.
Yeah, she's on the other side of the room. And she goes, I'm not coming over there. You want to show me off?
Exactly. No. I'm not some kind of model.
So she says no.
She says no. And unfortunately, she is dethroned. And she's no longer queen. And that's how Esther stepped in. We're talking about choices. We're talking about how important choices are. Mm-hmm. And every single day we wake up, we make a choice.
Yeah.
Like, are we going to get out of bed? Yes, we are. Are we going to brush our teeth? Hopefully. Mm-hmm. What are we going to wear today? You know, are we going to exercise? All those kind of things. What are we going to eat? It's all a choice.
Yeah.
Everybody makes choices. Making good choices can influence your relationships and improve your relationships. We're still on that healthy relationships topic, guys. And now we're talking about choice.
So, I don't know whether you're familiar with this, but just imagine in the conversation of life, right? There are four positions that you could take as an individual. The first position is the mover. So this comes from the four-player model, if you're familiar with it. So the first position is the mover. So in your life, you are moving, you are making choices about what should happen next. Mm-hmm. And then the second position is the follower. So you're either making choices about who you follow or choices about just following your feeling, inclination, intuition, whatever that might be. Mm-hmm. And then you've got the bystander who just watches life go past, not really making any meaningful choices that could get you going down the right path or up to wherever you aspire to be.
Mm-hmm.
And then the last position is the opposer.
Mm.
So the opposer is, you just oppose everything.
Kind of like
him. And you play the victim and you say, well, life is just going against me and I've got no say in all of this. The difference between an opposer and a bystander, the bystander literally just watches everything go by,
mm-hmm.
not make any meaningful choices. And the opposer, on the contrast, is actually somebody who takes a stance of, well, life is mean, life is not working for me, and you actually go against your own best interest.
Wow, that's really deep.
Going the wrong choices sometimes.
Your own best interests. Why would you want to go against your own best interests? Mm. I'm really interested in that one.
Well, it might be because either you're feeling trapped,
mm-hmm.
you're not taking enough time to actually look at what's my situation and how can I work to improve it.
And what choices do I have around me?
What choices do I have around me? What are the limitations
mm-hmm.
for me being able to actually make a meaningful choice mm-hmm. or choices?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the list goes on, but I think yeah. those are the three that sort of surface and come up at the top that I'm thinking about.
Yeah, and I think linking back to the last video we did last week, if you haven't watched it, it's a really good one to watch about working on yourself.
Mm.
It is that actually you have a choice in everything. You have a choice of who you get married to. You have a choice of who you're in a relationship with. You have a choice of what friends you have. You actually have a choice. So don't be the bystander or the opposer where you just watch your life go by. And the opposer who just goes, oh, I don't really have a choice. I'm a victim. You do have a choice. You could be the person who actually moves. Make a move, right? Make a move. Take action. That's something you're talking about today. Take charge.
Yeah, so I've been talking to Bethel recently about taking charge. And I think it comes from a book, but I can't remember. But I think the person that comes to mind who mentioned this is probably Jim Rohn or Zig Ziglar. And they're just talking about this idea of, when you get to those moments where you're feeling really low,
mm-hmm.
what can you do? What incremental change can you make
mm-hmm.
that will get you feeling somewhat better about your situation?
Mm-hmm.
And I think this taking charge is all about actually, what choices can I make in this particular situation
yes.
that will help me feel better mm-hmm. or move in the right direction?
Exactly. And I think this is, if you're a parent, by the way, this is crucial for you to listen. This starts right from when you become a parent, actually.
Yeah.
So I guess what comes first, the chicken and the egg, right?
That's a good question.
If you as a parent teach your child from a young age to make positive choices, and not only just to make positive choices, but how to make positive choices, because that's a thing in itself, learning how to make the right choices,
yeah.
having the right tools to make the right choices. So in this topic of healthy relationships, it's like, but I don't know how to choose a good guy.
Mm.
I don't know what that looks like, right? How do I know what that looks like? Especially if, unfortunately, you might have had negative role models. Maybe your own parenting or caregivers didn't show you what it was like to have a good relationship.
Yeah.
Or maybe you grew up in a single family or single parent household and you didn't see what that looked like, right?
Mm.
Maybe you were bullied at school. Maybe you didn't have positive friendships. Maybe you can't tap into anything that you can say, that's positive. I know what that looks like, right? And that's why we're doing this topic of healthy relationships. Mm. And we will do a video on how to spot red flags. What does healthy actually look like? Because it's so important,
yeah.
guys. So stay tuned. If you haven't subscribed, subscribe so you can get notifications. Hit the notification bell and keep listening if you want to know how to make better choices. So as parents, we have a boy called Micah Seth, and he, from a very young age, has been learning how to make good choices. So, of course, we're Christians. We talk to him about the Adam and Eve story. We talk to him about all the stories in the Bible which link to choices. So, something happens. We take Micah to the playground, and he meets this gorgeous girl. She's stunning, in fact.
He was only about, what, four?
4 days into moving into our new
house. No, three, but how old was he? I think it was about three, wasn't he, or something like that?
Yeah, three turning four.
I think it was about, yeah, three turning four.
And this girl was gorgeous. Honestly, one of the most gorgeous little girls, stunning blue eyes. And he was just like, wow, she pretty. And the reason we're using this example is it starts so young. It starts really, really young, right? He's looking at this girl. She's so pretty. She plays with him in the park and it's all gravy, right?
Because there was nobody there. It was just them two. They really had a great time.
They're both the same age. They play. They have an awesome time. He's like, oh, this girl is awesome, I'm going to marry her. He comes home saying, I'm going to marry her, right? Just from that one little interaction, guys, can we see how the interactions we have right from a child at influence 3 years old influences our choices, right? So we're like, oh, she's a cute girl. Not that we realistically think he's going to marry her, but okay, fine. Next time he sees that girl in the park, she's with her friends. How does that girl treat him? Terribly. In fact,
she just blanked him.
She completely blanks
him. Completely ignored him.
Runs away from him every time he tries to talk to her. He tries to enjoy, like, engage in the game, and she just honestly, it was heart-wrenching as a parent to watch. I didn't know what to do. I tried. You know, you try as a parent to get them to communicate, and then I just realized,
No.
Actually, no. This girl is ill-treating my son. And the mom was there, and, you know, I was chatting to the mom, but I did raise it. I was like, your child doesn't want to play with my child. What's going on? Oh, she's just like that because her friend's there. I was like, yeah, that's unacceptable. Actually, that's unacceptable. So the next time we were in the car, Micah Seth goes, oh, I want to marry her. I'm like, okay. Micah, I'm going to ask you a question. How does she treat you? She doesn't play with me? Okay. Is she kind to you? No, she's not kind to me. Okay. Do you think she respects you? No. So do you want to be married to somebody who's not kind to you, doesn't respect you, and doesn't treat you well when her friends are there? No. Good choice, Micah said. Well done. And it starts right there, right? So
I think I'm thinking about what was interesting with that situation is that you were there as a facilitator for this conversation to actually enable him and empower him to make the right kind of choice.
Exactly.
And I guess it gets me wondering about, you know, whether people out there actually have the same resources. You know, do they have a network of friends or people around them who would be able to actually get them to think outside of their framing and see things differently?
And this is why we're saying to parents, it's very crucial that you start from them. Because when you empower your child to say no from a young age, when you empower your child to look at what negative relationship is and what a healthy relationship is, and if they can
develop those
observation skills and say, this person, no. Then right from a young age, they're going to make those healthy choices, right?
It's a good point. Yeah, that's really good.
That is really crucial. And if you haven't had that upbringing and if you haven't been taught how to do that, then you need to surround yourselves with people who can help you. Look and observe, right? Really look into people's relationships. See how the husband treats the wife. See how the wife treats the husband. See how your friends treat each other. See how your friends treat you.
Yeah.
How do you treat other people, right? And then take inventory and think, okay, am I surrounding myself with people that can actually help me improve my relationships?
And I think it's a really good point, you know, talking about friendships, right? Because most people choose friends just based on, oh, you know, I just enjoy hanging out with them. Cool. They look cool.
They're handsome.
Or this, that about them.
They're cute. They're pretty.
Really and truly, you know, I think I learned this lesson. I think it was a book called, you know, The Power of Your Network or something like that. I can't remember the name of the title of the author. But it was talking about how do your relationships or the friendship groups that you have within your circle of influence actually either benefit you or help you in some way to get to where you want to get to.
Yes.
So even in thinking about, you know, the interaction with Bethel and Micah Seth, like just the fact that you were there as somebody, a friend, but you were actually consciously doing something or facilitating that conversation in a way that would empower him. So how do your friends do that for you?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's great to have friends that you just you can have good conversation with, but you want people that are also able to challenge you in some way to say, hey, excuse me, you know, on that point, you know, what are you doing about this? Or how do you feel about this? Or have you noticed that this is like that?
And I think if you're going to be in that position, then you have already needed to make a choice for yourself as to what direction do I want my life to go in? Am I going to be the bystander who just lets life pass me by and I'm okay with it and I'll just go with the wind, wherever the wind blows, there I'm going. Or you'd be like, I'm purposeful,
I'm driven,
I'm going to be a mover, I'm going to choose what direction I go in, I'm going to choose the positive path, and I'm going to make sure that the people around me are helping me to make that choice.
And I think it's a really good point about, you know, I know we used to think of it this way, but do you invest the right amount of time with the right people?
Yes.
Because the amount of time you invest, say, for example, in a network where they're not helping you get to where you want to get to, then that means you're opposing and you're doing something that's not in your best interest, yes, it might be great just for in terms of social, there's nothing wrong with that. Yeah. But we're talking about actually being challenged to grow to the next level.
100%. And again, that takes me back to the playground. I know you said for you it was a little bit different. For girls, it's slightly different, where you want to be friends with the popular girl because everybody likes the popular girl and you want to be liked, right? Normal, but you want to be liked for what, the wrong things? You want to be liked because your dress is pretty? You want to be liked for what you look like, not your brain or your character and those kind of things.
And I suppose it's age specific, to be fair, you know.
No, I think that's school, that's
but
like
it's good
up
thing
to now.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
You know, that even happens even in adulthood. It's like, oh, I've got the latest dress, I've got the latest shoes, I've got the latest car, I've got the latest house, the biggest
that's
house, the this, that.
That's true.
It's, what is that? Like, what even is that?
Choices.
Choices. It's choices, right? And I guess it's like, well, we've got that video on intimacy, the intimacy cover-up and things like that. Mm. And it's like, are we going to live a very shallow life and just be, you know, very appearance-led and just do that? Or are we going to choose to go deeper in ourselves? Are we going to choose to grow in ourselves? Are we going to choose to become the best version of ourselves? You know, and just from there, even when you're teaching kids or talking to kids about their choices, teaching them about the friendships, teaching them that, yes, I know it isn't great to not be popular, but actually in the future, this is the truth for me. The kids who were the least popular are the most successful.
In most cases, yeah.
In most cases, apart from the one-offs that become a superstar.
Yeah.
But the kids who were the least popular, the ones who were concentrating in school, the geeks, as it were called, in my year group, are the most successful. That's the truth. They have the most stable families, and they, to me, are the happiest in comparison to those who were the most popular for being the prettiest or whatever.
And the other thing I'm thinking about is those people who are feeling trapped because of the choices that they've made. So they've got to a position where they're thinking, oh my goodness, I made this choice to be here. And now that I'm here, I'm feeling trapped.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like I can't make any moves. Mm-hmm. I feel like I'm just going to be a bystander and be an opposer.
Mm-hmm.
So in thinking about your position, you might be feeling disempowered. You might be feeling like, I can't actually do anything to help the situation.
Yeah.
We're challenging you to actually look around within your own environment, within yourself, to see what you could do.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can make some sort of a choice to help you just make that tiny little step in the journey of 1,000 steps.
Exactly. And that takes us to the next point in our video, which is the ultimate choice. So there was somebody in the Bible that had to make a really hard choice, right? And I wonder if some of us would have made the choice he made. Joseph?
Oh, hi Mary.
I have something to tell you.
Yeah, sure, of course. You know we can talk about anything, right? That's okay.
I don't know if you're going to understand this one.
Okay, you sound really serious. What's the matter?
Well, there was an angel, and he said I was going to have a baby, and now I'm pregnant, and we're supposed to be getting married, and... But the child is from the Lord. I promise, I didn't cheat on you.
Did you say angel?
Yeah.
And did you say you have a baby?
Yeah.
Well, like, in you?
Yeah, like I'm expecting.
You probably did that. I don't know.
I don't know what Joseph went through, but guy, that would be hard. If your girlfriend came and said, like, an angel told her she was going to have a baby and now she's having the son of God. Like, really? What?
Well, to be fair, it was written in prophecy, but I don't know how often they read that. In order to remember. But as we know from the story, Joseph didn't think it would happen with Mary.
And well, so, nobody knew who it
was. So
he
still had
to
make the choice.
Yeah, and he wanted to actually put her away. He wasn't actually like, yeah, sure, let's do this. He was like, okay, you know what? Let me just save her dignity. I won't out her in public. I'll just gently, slowly walk away from this.
He's very PC.
You know, and just like, so... The angel of God actually has to come to Joseph and go, don't put her away. Which means he'd made his choice. His choice was, I think I'm going to put her away. But thankfully, because the angel came and spoke to him, he said, okay, fine. I'm going to endure the shame that comes with my wife being pregnant before we're married.
Yep.
People are either going to think, yeah, it's our baby, right? Or she cheated on me somehow and she's pregnant. No one is going to believe our story that this is the son of God. Like, really? Right, so that was a choice that Mary and Joseph both had to make to bring the Son of God into this world and to parent the Son of God. Oh my gosh, this leads us to the ultimate choice that we have to make. Are we going to make a choice to follow Christ, right? The disciples had to make a big choice, didn't they? When I think about Peter, a businessman making tons of money, you know, doing his thing. If you've watched The Chosen, oh my gosh, shout out to The Chosen, right? Peter is doing his thing, right? Yeah. Peter is not living a Jewish life in any way at this point when Jesus meets him.
That means not following all the laws not following the Torah. And the rules.
But Jesus finds him and he says, come follow me. Like, leave everything and come follow me. Guys, are we willing to leave everything and come and follow him? That's a huge choice that we all need to make. Right? And why is this important? Because I guess if you do choose to follow him, you are making probably one of the best choices you could make. In the sense that from then on, you now have an ultimate in your life that will help you to make better choices it's in like the rest of the area.
It's like a control tower.
Yes.
That is able to actually give you intuition.
Yes. When you don't know what to do, you're like, oh Lord, let's just say a little prayer. What are we supposed to do? And then he will help you to make that choice.
Yeah.
Remember we talked earlier about your decision-making process? So part of us as parenting is actually going, actually, no, Micah said, you know what? According to the Bible, when we're looking for a wife, this is what the person needs to be like.
Mm-hmm.
They need to fear God. They need to be kind. They need to be loving. They need to be all of these things, right? And so there's an ultimate. There's an ultimate attainment that we're going for, right? And that's really, really important.
And I think one of the most interesting things about the choice to follow Christ, when you think about a decision, every decision comes at a cost.
Mm-hmm.
And for those in business would know about opportunity cost,
yes.
Right? So following Christ is a sacrifice in itself. As we've just heard, Peter had to make sacrifices to do so.
Mm-hmm.
And even our own lives, when we take inventory, we look at, okay, what is it going to cost me to actually do this or do that? There's a price to pay for everything.
Mm-hmm.
So make sure the price that you're paying is the right price, because with every choice, you're paying a price anyway. So there's a price to be a bystander. There's a price to be an opposer.
Mm-hmm.
So make sure the choice that you make is actually getting you in the right direction to move towards your goal or your aspiration.
Something that really inspired me today, I got a link to a resurrection of a dead baby testimony, and that blew my mind. Right, and the link is in the description box, so if you want to watch that video, then you need to watch it, right?
Yeah.
What I loved about that video was that when the baby dies, right, the dad makes a choice. He decides call the pastor, right? He doesn't just freak out and do nothing. He decides call the pastor. He hands the baby to the pastor, right? And what happens next, I'm not going to tell you. You need to watch the video, and we're going to put the link right there.